mind. And as I was thinking, when the dog wakes up in the morning, it barks. When the cow wakes up in the morning, when the cat wakes up in the morning, it lets out a meow. When a duck wakes up in the morning, it lets out a quack, signifying that it's alive and well. And although we can't make those sounds, the sound that I made this morning coming out of my mouth was, thank you, Lord, for another bright and brand new day. And I started to think about the song where it says, let everything that have breath praise the Lord. So if you have an inhale and an exhale, let's give God the true and natural praise that he deserves. He's God Almighty. He's our Father. He deserves better than that. He brought us day out and day in. He let us see every day of this week. Let's say hallelujah. Thank you, God, for yet another chance at this thing called life. And so we do welcome you to the St. Timothy Community Church worship experience as we usher the Lord's Spirit in. And at this time, allow us to bow our heads for a word of prayer. Father God, in the name of Jesus, Lord, we thank you and we love you. Lord, we have solidarity in our hearts and purity in our hearts in coming forth before you, O Lord. Lord, we ask, God, as we have entered into the sanctuary, God, that you purge us with hyssop, that we may be clean. Wash us. And we may be whiter than snow, oh God. Lord, we ask, Father God, as we usher your presence in, that you rest, rule, and abide in us, oh God. Prick our hearts, Father God, and let us have an atmosphere conducive for worship. We thank you and we love you, God. We invite you and we welcome you and we want to meet you here, oh God, and have expectancy in our hearts for a life-changing experience. So we bless you and we thank you right now, oh God. In Jesus' name that we do pray, amen. Let's give God some praise as we have our praise and worship team.
Good morning, everyone. What a beautiful morning. Wonderful day to be in the house of the Lord. So we're going to ask everyone, stand on your feet, please, because we have come to praise the Lord. Praise his holy name.
Praise his holy name.
And lift Jesus.
Lift Jesus higher.
Oh, lift him higher.
Lift Jesus higher.
You can.
Lift him to
and to glorify.
To glorify.
And to praise.
I just came to praise
the Lord.
Praise the Lord.
hands together and let's give God some praise. Let him know that you came here to praise him. Oh, yeah. And never let that rock cry out in your place. In my place. Okay, come on, Alto. Yes, he is. All right now, don't let the rock cry out. Give God all the praise. Your praise. Never let that rock cry out in your place.
In his arms, I feel Good morning. Get your Bibles. Our scripture reading this morning will be coming from Galatians chapter 2, verses 16 through 19. I will be reading from the King James Version. Colossians chapter 2, verses 16 through 19. And the Word of God says, "Let no man therefore judge you in meat, or in drink, or in respect of any holy day, or of the new moon, or of the Sabbath days, which are a shadow of things to come. But the body is of Christ. Let no man beguile you of your reward in a voluntary humility and worshiping of angels, intruding into those things which he has not seen, vainly puffed up by his fleshly mind." Verse 19, "And not holding the head, from which all the body by joints and bands, having nourishment, ministered and knitted together, increaseth with the increase of God." This is the word of God for his people. We will now have our morning prayer by Reverend Curran.
At this time, we invite you to the altar for our altar call and morning prayer. Let us pray. Our Father, who is in heaven, holy is your name. Before we ask of anything, Lord, we ask for the forgiveness of our sins. Lord, we come to you with bowed down heads and humble hearts. God, some of us are in need, oh God, and we're seeking your face on our behalf. God, we understand your word says that you are the God of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob. But we've learned to have our own relationship with you, and you are our God. And for that, we do say thank you. Lord, we would be remiss if we did not thank you for this early morning's rising. Lord, we thank you that as we tossed and turned last night, that you kept a hedge of protection around our homes. You kept a hedge of protection around our beds, oh God. This morning when we woke up, we was not on our cooling board. But we were surrounded by the four walls of our bed, and that's enough to say thank you. God, you brought us from last Sunday to this Sunday, and that's enough to say thank you. Lord, you've been there in times of trouble and need, and that's enough to say thank you. Lord, you've been a bridge over troubled water, and that's enough to say thank you. And so, God, we have humility in our hearts and empowerment in our voice to praise your name, oh God. God, we understand that we are not perfect Christians, God, but we're striving for excellence in all that we do. Lord, some of us have struggles, oh God. God, some of us are seeking to be better, oh God. But I'm reminded of your word where it says you'll never leave us nor forsake us. And so, God, right now, Lord, I pray for our church, oh God. I pray for our sick and shut in, oh God. Lord, by the power in my voice, oh God, Lord, I ask that you be with them right now. Lord God, I ask that you continue to open up a window from heaven and pour out a blessing. God, it's not by our power and our might, but God, it's only by the power in your hands. And the power in your hands is able to dry up cancer. God is able to stop a heart attack. God is able to stop a stroke. God is able to clear up things. God, we understand that there's power in your name. And the power's name is Jesus. And so, Lord, as we call upon Jesus' name, oh God, we ask that you rebuke the enemy in the name of Jesus. That any attack that he has for us, God, that you block it right now. So, God, we thank you, God, for every youth that's in this church, oh God. We thank you for their at-home life and their school lives, oh God. God, we understand, God, that we may not understand what they go through, oh God. But, Lord, I ask for, Lord, the healing of mindsets, oh God. The changing of mindsets, oh God. God, allow, God, we ask, Father God, for us not to be consumed by our mind, God, but consumed by your spirit. And so, Lord, we pray with dignity in our hearts as we stand flat-footed and as we sit on today, oh God, that you are Lord and Savior. And so, Lord, we thank you and we love you. God, be over this city, oh God. Be over this state, oh God, over this nation, oh God. We understand that you sit high, you look low, God, but you're not too far for us to reach you. And, Lord, all we have to do is say hallelujah. All we have to do is say thank you, Jesus. All we have to do is lift up our holy hands unto your name and, God, receive a miracle. And, God, even if we don't need anything, God, we just want to say we're happy to be in your presence. So, God, we thank you and we love you. God, purge us with hyssop that we may be clean. Wash us that we may be whiter than snow. To be acceptable in your eyesight, oh God. And that's what we long for, God. Because your word says, now unto you, that's able to keep us from falling and present us faultless, oh God. And in our lives full of fault, God, we thank you for looking at us blameless. So we thank you and we love you. Bless our worship experience, oh God. Continue to bless us. In Jesus' name that we do pray, amen. Amen. Let's give God some praise. As we return back to our seats, if we all could stand, those that are able to stand for our morning hymn.
Those of you who have your hymnals, please turn to number 240 as we sing Love Lifted Me. If not, you can look on the screen. Hopefully these words will be coming up. We want everyone to join in with us this morning. I was sinking deep in sin, far from the peaceful shore. Ready. souls in danger.
Souls in danger. Look above.
Jesus complete.
He will lift you.
First, giving honor to God, to Pastor Jackson, Pastor Curran, Minister Blue, and to all ministers, members, and visitors of St. Timothy Community Church, good morning. The announcements for the morning are as follows. Please remember to read the announcements in your bulletins and govern yourselves accordingly. We would like to thank our volunteer greeters for the morning. Will you please stand and be recognized at this time? Do not be anxious about anything, but in every situation, by prayer and petition, with thanksgiving, present your requests to God. And the peace of God, which transcends all understanding, will guard your hearts and your minds in Christ Jesus. Philippians 4, 6 through 7. Join us on Wednesday at noon by dialing 1-312-626-6799 and enter meeting ID number 432-693-8337. Remember our sick. Continue prayers for our beloved members who are ill and or recovering from surgery. Lenora Barnes, Laura Burton, Michael Dumas, Barbara Jackson, Michael Prowell, Judith Hall. Please contact the church office to be added to the sick and shut-in list and for pastor to know who is sick and shut-in. Join us for Bible study every Wednesday at 6:45 p.m. and Thursday at 2 o'clock p.m. in person and or online. You may dial in at 1-312-626-6799 and enter meeting ID number 432-693-8337. STCC Sunday School Department will have Easter speeches available today after service for the children, as well as poems for the older children. Meet us in the REL Center following service. There are still members that have not picked up their contribution envelopes for 2024. Envelopes are located by the receptionist desk. Please pick up your envelope. Please listen to the following community announcements. Expanding Pathways to Better Futures. UNCF Mayor's Breakfast, Northwest Indiana 2024, hosted by the Honorable Mayor Eddie Melton, Gary, Indiana. Honoring the Legacy, Transforming Our Future. This will be held Wednesday, February 21st, 2024, from 8:30 a.m. to 10 a.m. Central Standard Time, at the Gary Erie Career Center, 1800 East 35th Avenue, Gary, Indiana. For more information, you may contact email address indianapolis@uncf.org. Supporting HBCUs and students in need. Edgewater Health presents a stage play, The Garage, written by Michael A. Woods. This will be held February 22nd and February 23rd at 7 p.m. at Westside Theater, 9th and Jerry Street, Gary, Indiana. Ticket prices are $25. For tickets or more information, you may contact edgewaterhealth.org. As they present the 2024 Gentle Warrior Awards, Black Tie Event Live Entertainment, Saturday, February 24, 2024, from 5 to 10 p.m. Guest MC from ABC 7, Jose Sanders. This will be held at Wintrust Grand Banking Hall, 231 South LaSalle Street, valet parking. For tickets, sponsorships, graduatory ads, and the list of the 2024 honorees, you may go to the website aprgentlewarriorsawards.com. This announcement comes from the Urban League of Northwest Indiana. Let's get together. We're hosting an event and we'd love to see you there. Join us for 2024 Diversity and Inclusion Symposium. This will be held March 14, 2024 at 8:30 a.m. at Valparaiso University, 1509 Chapel Drive, Valparaiso, Indiana. Register soon because space is limited. We hope you're able to join us. And at this time, will Trustee Board President Greg Jones please come forward?
Good morning, church family. Good morning. Another year has passed, and it's time again for our annual church business meeting. So we're inviting you all out on April 21st. And as it is our tradition and in our bylaws, we announce the business meeting, and that also opens the door for those who want to apply for a trustee, to become a trustee. Applications are at the reception desk, just in case there's four positions that are open. We just ask that you wait till the sermon is over before you rush out and get the applications. So please, it is a lot of work to be a trustee, and we appreciate the trust that you've put in us, but we're always looking for some good people. So today we will have a meeting with the nomination committee. And those they are the people who are presidents of the various auxiliaries. We'll meet and set up the nomination committee. You will have until March the 15th to submit your application, and then we'll go through and create the ballots and have that vote, and then that will be presented at the business meeting on April 21st. So more information will be coming, but I just wanted to make you aware there will be a business meeting on April 21st. And also give you an opportunity to apply for a trustee position. Thank you so much.
And that concludes our announcements for the morning. At this time, we would like to recognize our visitors. We are pleased that you chose St. Timothy as your place of worship today. And it's our sincere hope that you would come and visit with us again. I did not receive any visitors' cards. If there are any visitors, will you please stand and be recognized at this time? And a microphone will be coming around for you to give us your name.
Good morning, church. My name is Richard Caldwell.
Amen.
Thank you. Good morning. My name is Darlene Daniels, visiting from Jerusalem Missionary Baptist Church. Reverend Isaac Culver Jr. is our pastor. Thank you.
Amen. Good morning. My name is Ken. I'm from Houston, Texas, and I'm glad to be here. Thank you.
Are there any additional visitors? Will you please stand at this time? Welcome to all of our visitors. St. Timothy, let's give our visitors a warm St. Timothy welcome.
As we welcome our visitors this morning, let us greet one another, let us fellowship with one another. Before we move on in our worship experience, I'm going to ask Pastor Kern to come. He has an announcement to make, and then I'll make a few more comments, and then we'll move forward in our worship through giving.
Good morning, church family. I won't be before you long, but I do have a quick announcement to make in regard to the Chicago Bulls trip. On Wednesday, again, February 28th, we'll be going to the Chicago Bulls game, the youth, and you don't have to be just a youth to go, but you can participate if you would like to. The tickets are $100. That ticket includes your Bulls ticket, it includes transportation to the game, and includes lunch. Now the lunch we have Popeye's chicken along with churches. So listen, I understand our culture, we like chicken. No, I'm just kidding. But we have sandwiches and snacks and things like that for everyone that's going. And so today after service, see Brother Comer or myself, and we have everything readily available to you. So when you purchase your ticket, you can also fill out which sandwich you got between turkey, ham, and a vegetarian option as well. And so, again, we do charge and implore you to come out and be a part of that experience. And we're leaving here from the church on that Wednesday at 5 p.m., all right? 5 p.m. is when we will leave to go see the Chicago Bulls play the Cleveland Cavaliers. And if you know anything about the Cavaliers, there's a young man from Gary, Indiana, that plays for the Cleveland Cavaliers. His name is Darius Garland. And so we're going to see Darius Garland and the Chicago Bulls. So if you would like to come, please see myself or Brother Comer. Again, tickets are $100. Thank you all. God bless.
And I'll be playing during halftime. I can't even run and dribble the ball at the same time. So I just want to make a quick additional announcements. There are, for the mayor's breakfast that's coming up on the 21st, if you desire, our church is going to purchase a table. And so if you desire to be a part of that, please call the church office and or email the church requesting a ticket. It's free, it's no cost to you, but it'd be first come, first serve. Those that I like that early morning breakfast and to be a part of that experience. Please call the church to put your name on the list. Also, the play, The Garage, we have been blessed through Edgewater with 60 tickets. So I have 30 tickets for each night. So if you want to go to that play and you don't have to pay anything, we've been given free tickets for all the work that we do in the community and as we help to support Edgewater and all of their programs as it relates to the community. They wanted to be a blessing to St. Timothy, and I thought it was marvelous. Amen. Amen. So again, just give the church a call or after service, even today, if you want to mention to me you would like a ticket, just let me know. I'll have the tickets available, and we'll give those out for that Thursday and Friday. Next Sunday will be our last Sunday of this month, and we usually conclude with our Black History Month celebrations. We have a wonderful service of celebration plan for next Sunday, so you don't want to miss it. And we encourage you to invite someone to church next Sunday as we have our dancers will be dancing, and we have other special things happening within the service. And then we have something prepared for you after service. I don't know what it is yet, but we'll let you know next Sunday. And lastly, but certainly not least, I want to introduce you all. Many of you have seen him before, but my son is here with us, and he'll be living with me. And so we want to welcome him to the Gary, Indiana, and Northwest Indiana area, and certainly to our church. I asked him to stand. He's in the back there. So his name is Andre. And so you all welcome Andre. He turned 18 on this past Friday, so he grown. So please, I know that we do what we do here at St. Timothy. Welcome him here, as we always welcome our visitors, and particularly those who are affiliated with our church. We're so glad that God has blessed each and every one of us and given us the opportunity to be a blessing in our lives, as he has blessed us through either an opportunity to work and to make means to take care of ourselves. But then God gives us a portion to be able to give back unto him. And we want to take the portion God has given unto us to be a blessing to the ministry of St. Timothy Community Church, as we are blessing to not only this church, but through the ministry of this church, we are blessing to the community and the vicinity. And so we want to continue our efforts, and it's because of your giving, your faithfulness, that has allowed us to do the ministry that God has allowed us to do. Each and every day and every month. There's a whole lot of stuff we do here at St. Timothy that I don't think our membership really understands the magnitude of what we do behind the scenes. And there are things that even done as me as the pastor, through me as the pastor, confidentially blessing people. And it's because of your giving and your support that I'm able to, along with others, to be a support to those, not only in our church, but those also in our community as well. And we want to keep that going. So let me just say publicly, thank you for your faithfulness and your giving to this church, as it not only pleases God, but it helps to bless others. If we can just stand over the sanctuary as we move forward in our affirmation statement. And our affirmation statement is there so that we can collectively and corporately as a body of believers believe in the institution of the tithes and offerings that Malachi talks about, that provides provision for the church and provision for the ministry, but also is an opportunity for us to sacrifice and give unto the Lord. And the ushers, our youth ushers, are ushering this morning. Amen. They look wonderful. We're going to ask them to come, and those that are unable physically to come to the altar to give, if you would just give your offering at this time as the musicians play very softly and as the youth ushers are coming. There are some members who are not able to walk, and so we want to give you an opportunity to give. And then in a moment, we all are going to walk around and give our offering. Amen. Just slip up your hand with your offering for those who are not able to walk. Those who are not able to walk. Amen. If you got two legs and able to move, we want you to be able to move. But there are members who are not able to walk, and we want to give them an opportunity to give. Amen. Thank you for being obedient. Amen. Thank you so much. Because the Bible does tell us to bring our tithes and to bring our offerings to the storehouse. Amen. That there may be meat in the house of God. As the affirmation is pulled up, as we state the affirmation together as a body of believers, let us repeat together. The Word of God tells us to worship the Lord through the giving of tithes and offerings. Tithing is an act of faith that shows that I am committed to God and the work of the kingdom. Tithing releases joy, prosperity, wealth, health, and favor in my life. Tithing ensures that my finances are blessed, and that my harvest will be exceptionally and lasting. Generously I give, and richly I receive. And so, because I am blessed, and because I am grateful for the Lord's grace and mercy, I lovingly give at least 10% of my increase back to the Lord. According to Malachi 3:10, bring ye all tithes into the storehouse, that there may be meat in my house, and prove me now where within, saith the Lord of hosts, if I will not open you the windows of heaven, and pour you out the blessing, that there shall be no room enough to receive it. I shall walk in kingdom abundance and authority all the days of my life. The floodgates of heaven are open, the curse of the endower is broken, and I am living in the abundance of the overflow. Amen. As you come and as you follow the directions of the ushers, if you will face left and follow the directions of the ushers and come down and give your offering unto the Lord. As the musicians play an upbeat, something upbeat to give us the spirit of giving. Amen. Those that are online that are giving, there are ways that you can give electronically. You can give through our Zelle. We can type in St.Timothy@hotmail.com. You can give through Givelify. You would type in the church's name, St. Timothy Community Church, Gary, Indiana. Those that are on our website can go to and click to the donate button, and you can give through our PayPal. St. Timothy Community Church also has a church app. You can download the church app and you can give through the Apple or Android store. And lastly, you can also mail your offering to 1600 West 25th Avenue, Gary, Indiana, 46410. Thank you for your giving. As the ushers face the altar and as we pray together, let us pray. Almighty God, we thank you for the act of giving, which is a part of our worship. And God, we give unto you, O Lord, because you have given so much unto us. And so, Lord, we give a percentage back unto you, O God, that we may be blessed, and that your house may be blessed, and that the people of God may be blessed. And now, God, bless the giver and bless the gifts. It's in Jesus' name we pray, and the people of God say together, amen. Amen. God bless you, and thank you again for your generosity and your faithfulness. Our music ministry is going to come at this time and give us a selection. If there are any youth, our youth ministry, through Pastor Curran, will now go to their youth church. So any youth that are present, you can follow Pastor Curran to youth church. Thank you.
So you think that you can't make it through, and you feel like, oh, don't you ever give up. Don't.
wonderful thing to know that he cares for us. Amen. Our scripture lesson this week from the book of Colossians chapter 2. Book of Colossians chapter 2. And we have read together verses 16 to 19, but I want you to keep your Bibles open as we're going to travel through verses 16, 17, 18, and 19 through the Word of God this morning. But let me just read a few verses to center ourselves to the Word of God. Colossians chapter 2, verses 16 through 19. Reading from the NIV translation, it says this: "Therefore, do not let anyone judge you by what you eat or drink, or with regard to religious festivals, a new moon celebration, or a Sabbath day. These are a shadow of the things that were to come. The reality, however, is found in Christ." I want to park there for our thought this morning through the Word of God. I want to talk about I'm satisfied in Jesus. I'm satisfied in Jesus. Let us pray. Almighty God, we thank you for thy word. Speak to us collectively and individually. Speak to our hearts, our minds. Give us clarity. Let us hear your voice. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. In keeping with the celebration of Black History and Black History Month, I did some research and some study on the Black church and where we have come, or how far we have come from as a people and as a church and as believers. I read some articles that took me back to the early 1800s, where most slaves in the United States have not been converted yet to Christianity. But years to follow, however, there was a widespread of Protestant evangelism emphasizing individual freedom and direct communication with God, brought forth by large gatherings of enslaved men and women. These large number of Black men and women were converted during an intensified revival. We do revivals now where we revive to revive our spirit, our souls. But their revivals then encouraged them, gave them faith to believe in freedom. It's later, the Baptists and Methodist ministers appeal to the slave and free Black populations, preaching just a plain style message of hope, of redemption, while also catering to their worship. The men and women would carry their joyfulness, even being enslaved, their call and response singing. They're shouting and they're dancing as they celebrated and lifted up a God who they had hope in to liberate them. And even so, with as much religious life of the slave community that had existed, which was called the invisible church, and I teach this in theology and social justice, that there's this invisible church where the people of God who were enslaved came together and still worshiped God. Slave
preachers who were later given the authority to preach to black folks emphasized their obedience to the master while whites were present. But among other slaves, they would teach. They would emphasize themes of suffering and redemption. But also, they would emphasize freedom. Slave songs and spirituals would fill the atmosphere. Biblical references around Moses, who led his people to freedom. And on occasions, these songs that would give expression would help them to be resilient and to help them to resist. It would help them to also encode in their messages of song, secret gatherings, and carrying direction on how they're going to escape. And here we are today, still trying to figure out how we're going to overcome. Many of our African American or our black churches are emptying out. There seems to be very little or to no reverence to God and faith in the black church, where our ancestors have already shown us the pathway, and that is we overcome with unity. We overcome when we can come together as a people through the church, through our faith in God, to make a difference in society. But if we're going to continue to survive in our society and in our life, we're going to need our faith in God, our faith in the church, and a strong faith in knowing that God is on the side of the oppressed. The secret to spiritual success is living on the basis of who Jesus Christ is, what he has already done for us as a people. We become Christians by our faith in Jesus Christ. Paul says this in his second letter to the believers in Corinth in chapter 5, verse 7, where he says, "We walk by faith and not by sight." Paul teaches us as believers, particularly those in Corinth, that in order to move forward, we must exercise our faith and not just rely on our sight. Well, we all can identify to that, because you got here this morning on your sight. Oh yeah, you got here on your sight. You could not have found your way through the different roads and the stop signs and the red lights if you didn't see where you were going. But life oftentimes causes us to not just rely on our sight, because our sight can fail us, but we must also rely on our faith. We must be able to see not just physically, but spiritually. We must be able to see God in circumstances in which our sight can't see, but our faith can see better. And so Paul talks to the church, talks to believers in Corinth, but now he's addressing those in Colossia. Paul teaches the lesson to the believers in Colossia that they must not be influenced by the false teachings in their community. Paul tells them that they are false teachers, they are false doctrines, they are false philosophies that are being taught. And Paul tells them that we must turn from Gnosticism. Gnostic is the knowledge. It is the idea that only through knowledge do people find salvation. There were philosophers in Colossia that was teaching the people of God that all you need is the know. All you need is knowledge. In other words, they was teaching them that you don't need Jesus to be saved. And Paul comes into the city of Colossia and deals with not the non-believer, but the believers. And he tells them that, no, your knowledge can't save you, but Jesus can save you. He gives them teaching. He gives them instruction. He reminds them of who they are and whose they are. What I'm suggesting to us today is that we got to be careful not to allow ourselves or even the devil to trick us in telling us that we know it all and that all we need is us and we don't need nothing else and no one else in order to make it. But I believe many of us this morning can testify for a few moments and say, I thought I knew everything. I thought I knew how to do it on my own, but there became a time in my life where I couldn't rely just on my own knowledge, my own understanding, but there are times where God had to cause me to bow down and to humble myself to be able to submit to his authority and his understanding and his knowledge. And I submit that I didn't arrive here today, not on my own accord, but I arrived here today because I'm under a rock. I'm under a rock called Jesus Christ. I'm under one who has not only redeemed me, but saved me, but has delivered me and set me free. I'm under the one who has instructed me. When I went left, he brought me right. When I went down, he brought me up. When I couldn't make it over, he helped me to climb over some things in my life. And many of us can come here this morning and say that I've gotten here because of the grace and the mercy of God. I've gotten here because it was God that was on my side. I got here today because it was a God that remembered me. Paul teaches the believers in Colossians that you have to rely on Jesus Christ, who is Lord over our lives. And you must not only rely on him, but you must be satisfied in Jesus. And I would submit today that if we just rely on what we have to satisfy us, oh, I know we want that famous car, that fancy car, that'll satisfy us. We want to make that $75,000 or $100,000 salary, that'll satisfy us. Oh, if we get the biggest house on the block, that will satisfy us. But what happens when the house is gone? What happens when the car breaks down? What happens when the money dries up? And the only thing that's consistent in our lives is God through Jesus Christ, our Lord. And if we can understand that if we have God in our lives, that we can be satisfied. Have you ever been satisfied and content even when I don't have it? I just say thank you, God, because I praise him for what I do have. I'm talking about being content, being satisfied in Jesus, that when we are satisfied in Jesus, no matter what happens in our lives, that we are able to be able to hold ourselves together because we're in Christ. There's a story that's told. It's entitled Never Satisfied. Have you ever met someone who was never satisfied? All right, if you didn't say nothing, maybe I'm talking about yourself. Never satisfied about anything. There are two friends met in the street, and one looked sad and almost on the verge of tears. The one man said to the other, he said, hey man, how come you look like the whole world has caved in on you? The sad fella said to his friend, he said, well, let me tell you, 3 weeks ago, my uncle died and left me $50,000. Well, he said, that's not bad at all. He said, hold on, the story gets better. He said, 2 weeks ago, a cousin had kicked the bucket, and he died and left me $95,000. He says, well, that's great. I would like that. He said, no, but last week, my grandfather passed away, and I inherited almost $1 million. The man said, that's exciting news. Not that he died, but the money that he left you. He said, no, no. He said, but this week, nothing happened. Sometimes we can get dissatisfied, but we ought to be satisfied. Are we really satisfied in Jesus? Are we really content in Christ? And Paul teaches us as believers, today, we must be satisfied in Jesus. Let me give you three things Paul says. Number one, he says, if we're going to be satisfied in Jesus, one, we must not lose our focus or don't focus on the judgmental opinions of others concerning us. Paul tells the believers, verse 16, therefore do not let anyone judge you by what you eat, So go ahead and get them ham hocks. Or what you drink, I'll leave that up to your imagination. Or with regard to your religious festivals, you know, when you come to church, you celebrate, like we're celebrating Black History Month. Someone may say, well, why are you going to church and celebrating blackness? Well, because God created me to be black. And I'm going to celebrate the God who's created me to be who I am. Or the moon celebration, or the Sabbath day. So Paul says to the believers, stop letting folks or listen to people who are judgmental, who look at your life and want to tear it apart, and focus on every little thing that you do. But be satisfied in Jesus means that whatever I do in Christ that uplifts Christ, if you don't like it, then you talk to God about it. But as long as I'm in Christ and as long as I'm in Jesus and doing the things of God that celebrate my life and celebrate God, look at somebody and tell them, that's all right. That's all right. Paul says to the church, don't allow people's judgmental spirit concerning you to bother you. Stop being bothered by what people say. Then he says to them, if you're going to be satisfied in Jesus, here's the second thing I want to leave you. You're satisfied in him when you do not let unspiritual mindsets of others influence your spiritual mindset. Oh, that's deep. Because sometimes while we're in Christ, we're in the Word of God, and we have a relationship with God, why do we pay attention and listen to people whose mindset is not in Christ? They don't think theologically. They don't think about God. They react on their own knowledge and understanding. The Lord is teaching the people of God in Colossians that in spite of these philosophies that are being taught to you, he says, there's only one word that you ought to have, and that word is Jesus. Following the disciples and the teachings of Christ. So this unspiritual mindset. Think about when you're in trouble and when you have to make a decision about something, who do you call? Who do you talk to? And sometimes we get on the phone and we talk to some family and friends or loved ones, or we talk to someone that may not have a spiritual mindset. Therefore, they don't give you a spiritual answer. And then the end result is that you all jacked up and messed up. Because God always tries to give a message to us. And sometimes, oftentimes, God communicates with us as believers through other people. Particularly people who are believers. So if you're trying to get a prayer through, don't go to nobody who don't believe God who's an atheist. I got to find somebody who believes God. Because there's some issues going on in my life that I need someone who has a relationship with him that can help get a prayer through. That can give me some spiritual guidance that could say, you know what, I've been there, done that myself, but let me tell you how God delivered me, how God set me free. That's a spiritual mindset. So Paul says in verse 18, do not let anyone who delights in false humility and in worshiping of angels disqualify you, such as people also go into great detail about what they have seen. They are puffed up with idle notions by their unspiritual mind. Watch who you connect yourself with. Protect your spiritual mindset. Here's the last thing. If we're going to be satisfied in Christ, it's in verse 19. that we are satisfied in Jesus when we don't lose connection with the head. Who's the head? The head is Jesus. Verse 19 says, and they have lost connection with the head, from whom the whole body, supported and held together by its ligaments and sinews, or the joints, grows as God causes it to grow. Paul says that if we're going to be satisfied in Jesus, we have to make sure we're not disconnected from him. So the question then is, what disconnects us from him? What disconnects us from the head, who is Jesus Christ? Our problems. Oh, come on, we be real with ourselves. Soon as you hit a problem hits you, we're crying about it. We're falling apart about it. We don't know how it's going to work out. That's being disconnected. When we allow the devil to play tricks with us, or with our minds, and discourage us and causes us to be helpless and hopeless, that's a disconnect from the head. But when we are connected with the head, that means we are focused even when it seems as if life is trying to pull us away from him. But I believe when Paul says, you've got to press to the mark, you've got to endure to the end. And so no matter what the challenges that we face in our lives, that we got to keep on pushing and keep on focusing on the fact that we are connected with the head. Now, Pastor, how do I know when I'm connected with the head? Well, when trouble comes, you know who to call on, Jesus the Christ. How do I know when I'm connected to the head? Is that when it seems like you have more money, more problems than you have money, and you're still able to smile and rejoice? That's how you know you're connected to the head. How do you know when you're connected to the head? It seems when health issues have attacked your body, but yet you can still tell the doctor, I have a God that can heal thee, and I'm going to still pray to my God, and one day he's going to heal me. When you're connected with the head, you may be in despair, you may be in trouble, but something happens on the inside of us that helps us to reconnect with whose we are and who we serve. And when we are connected to the head, can't no devil in hell pull us down. Can't no devil in hell tear us apart. Is there anybody here this morning that says, sometimes I feel disconnected? How do I get connected, Pastor? You get connected by reminding yourself that I am a child of the Most High God. How do I get connected with God? You got to realize that not only who you are, that he saved you, and when he saves us not just for a day, he saves us for eternity. As long as we are saved by the Almighty God, no matter what happens in our lives, we can say, I'm saved, I'm sanctified, and I'm Holy Ghost filled, because I'm connected to the head. And so there I am encouraged this morning, because I know who I'm connected to. Oh, I know you've got some stuff going on, but know who you are attached to. And the Bible lets us know, even in David says, I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, and I fear no evil. Why? Because who's with you? God is with me. Why is God with me? Because I am connected to the head. And so long as I'm connected to the head, wherever I go, guess what? The head is with me. I go to the barber shop, the head is with me. I go to the job and sit at the desk, and employers and may get on my nerves, employees may get on my nerves. But because I'm connected to the head, I can count to 10 and breathe 3 times and remind myself that it's a God that keeps me together. You've got to be connected to the head. Think about the body. You chop your head off right now, what's going to happen? What's going to happen? You chop your head off. You're going to be dead. Your arms ain't going to move. Legs ain't gonna move. All we're gonna see is there's a dead body laying there. That's what happens to us spiritually when we allow the enemy to attack the head, to attack our spirit. We're just laying there dead. But I believe God wants to revive his people and keep us revived, keep our spirits uplifted. And the only way to do that is making sure the head is intact. So I want to encourage you, in order to stay satisfied in Christ, is to make sure you don't allow people to be judgmental over your life and you take that negativity in. Make sure that you are satisfied in Christ when you know that you are connected. Even when people say you ain't connected to no Jesus. I always say when people point a finger, they say there's how many fingers pointing back at you? So make sure you ain't pointing the finger at folk. Don't tell me who I'm not connected with. And even when it looks like I'm not all the way together, God ain't finished with me yet. He's still working on the inside of me, getting me together. And so one day I come out, Brother Comer, looking like pure gold. Not that fake gold, y'all know. Looking like pure gold. Looking like nothing I've never been through. I haven't been through anything. That's one way to look. People can look at you right now. And if you would tell them the story of what has happened to you through life, they wouldn't even believe it because of what you look like today. But I challenge us, remember I said us, I'm in this thing too, to keep on connecting to our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ so we can keep looking the image of Christ. What's the image of Christ? It's the characteristics of Christ. That's what Christ looks like. I know we put this painting and we picture Jesus as this white man with this blonde hair, blue eyes. Now that may be your Jesus, but I ain't that my Jesus. And I ain't gonna fault you if that's your Jesus, but my Jesus, he black. He black, Pastor? He black. That's my Jesus. Bible describes him as wool hair. That's that nappy hair. And look where he was born. Born in Africa. What? What you say? And he's liberating us as a people. So we don't have to walk around like we're not liberated. We're not free. Stop letting people and things bound you or bind you. But who the Son sets free. Do y'all believe that? Who the Son sets free is free indeed. Who's the Son? Jesus is the Son of God. And whom he sets free is free indeed. So you're free from the cares of this world. You're free from the troubles of this world. You even free from yourself. Because our own fears, our own insecurities will hold us on, our own selves bound. But I want you to concentrate on freeing yourself this week. That's what I want you to take with you. Whatever it is that is holding you bound and holding you hostage, I want you to write it down during the week. And during this week, I want you to pray over it and say, God, I need to be free from this. I need to be liberated from this. And whatever your this is, we all got it. Free yourself this week. Let us all stand all over the sanctuary. I'm satisfied. I'm content in Jesus, in the Word of God, in the church. I'm content in my worship, in my prayers. I'm content in my service, in my ministry. I'm satisfied being a child of God, being a believer. I'm content in my giving, in lining myself up and my life up in the will of God. I'm all right with that. No matter what the world may be doing and others may be doing, I got to put the mirror and reflection in my own life. In this Lenten season, I want us to challenge ourselves, pick up the mirror, and view yourself. What are the areas in my life that I need to work on? That's what the Lenten season is about. Let's not go through another Lenten season and say, I'm gonna give up chocolates. I'm gonna give up soda. I'm gonna give up chicken wings. I don't know about that. But let's just not say I'm gonna give up. But I want you to put that mirror in front of yourself these next 40 days of Lent and say, I'm looking at me in the mirror. God, help me to be a better me.
Yes, yes.
Help me to work on me. The first step this morning may be someone hears and says, I'm not saved, and I want to accept Christ as Lord and Savior in my life. What do I do, Pastor, Preacher? We welcome you to come to the altar. Meet me at the altar here. We'd love for you to be a part of this church, but most of all, be a part of the kingdom of God. What does that mean? Paul says, to be a part of this body of believers, one has to confess with one's mouth and believe in one's heart that he is Lord. And I want to offer you, my brother, my sister, salvation. All I can do is offer it, but you have to receive it. Like any gift, if someone gifts you something, you have to receive the gift in order for that gift to benefit you. But the gift this morning is Jesus Christ. Let me offer the gift of Christ to you. Would you come, my brother? Would you come, my sister? Second call is, I'm already saved, but I don't have a church home, and I want this church to be my church home. Under Christian Experience, I want to come. We offer that to you, my brothers, my sister. Would you come? He will give you life, and he will give it to you more abundantly. He will give you brand new life, life abundantly, life abundantly. Oh, come. Is the one that hears the call.
Come on.
Come to Christ. To Christ. Amen. Christ. life abundantly,
life abundantly.
Oh,
come
on, come
on
to Christ,
to Christ.
Amen. You may be seated if you're not able to stand. You may be seated.
Giving all honor and glory to our Heavenly Father and to His Son, Jesus the Christ, to Pastor Jackson, to Minister Blue and Reverend Karen, to members of St. Timothy Community Church. We have today joining the body of Christ at St. Timothy Community Church, Pastor's son, Andre Jackson. He is coming to accept Jesus Christ as his Savior. And his birth month is February.
Those in the month of February, just stand so he can see you. All right. So our church is, first of all, this is my son. Like I said before, he's living with me. And I'm learning, and you as parents understand this, sometimes as parents, we want our kids to do well, right? And sometimes we overly, you know, push them. And I'm learning, we got to let God do God what God does. And so I told him, I said, we all make mistakes in life, but the thing about it is, God gives us a restart. God gives us another opportunity, another chance. And all of us who have children, you know, I learned this week I was at a meeting actually, and for the Urban League, and one of my colleagues said to me, who was, you know, kind of struggling with her kids, she said, you know what, Pastor Jackson, my husband and I have learned to be not just parents, but to be life coaches to our children. And you know, that really, like a light bulb went off. I'm like, you know what? Because they get to an age where they want to be grown and be grown. So now you have to make decisions on your own because you're grown. And so I've learned, and it was confirmation for me, and I'm trying to help some parents. It was confirmation to me that let your children, let them go. Release them. And be life coaches. Be there to coach them and say, you know, this is an option, this is an option, this is an option. Now take these options and now you figure it out. And I think that's the best thing we can do with our kids as they are teenagers, is they're gonna have to figure their and find their way. But as they find their way, we as parents right on that side like coaching them. And even when they mess up, we jump right in that and come on, get up, get moving, stop crying about it. So I want to encourage all of us as parents, let's not be, you know, that parent that's just, we get frustrated because we're trying to get our kids to a certain level or a certain place in life, but release them. You've done all you can do. Bible says train up a child in the way they should go. And when they get old, they will what? Not depart. And so they get 18, they get 20, they get 30, and you're like, Lord, what's going on? They're still growing. They're still growing in the Lord. Let them grow in the Lord. Let God oversee them and move out the way, because you're in the way. I don't know who that's for. Move out the way. You're in the way. And let them begin to develop their life, their relationship with God, and let God pick them up when they fall. Amen, somebody?
Amen.
Now, that's a whole nother sermon by itself. I can preach another 30 more minutes if you want. Amen. Amen. So we welcome you, son. And
And so they'll take more information and stuff for you from you, and we just celebrate. So y'all greet him after service. I usually do young people, you know, come up, but I know they're all in the back and all over the place to welcome him. And so I just ask that that you welcome him to the church. Amen.
Amen.
Amen. Amen. Let's all stand. Let us pray. Almighty God, we thank you for your Son, Jesus the Christ.
Yes.
And God, we thank you for your word today that we have feasted at the table to remind us that we are satisfied and content in you. Now, as we go forth in this week, protect us, guide us, help us, remind us to be content no matter what circumstance that we are in. Now unto him who is able to keep us from falling, to the only wise God, who has all majesty and dominion now and forevermore, and the people of God say together, amen.
Amen.
Amen. God bless you. Go in peace. Follow the directions of the ushers.